Happy New Year! It's 2016. I think this year's going to be great. That's my feeling. Nothing can possibly go wrong. Welcome to my office. These are the times that I've killed, and these are the times I will kill again. I'm nearly at my 200th victim of murders, and so far I have not been caught. Hopefully that doesn't give the police some kind of clue. This is RHLSTP. This week's guest is returning, David Mitchell. He's one of my favourite guests, maybe the favourite guest, I was going to say, of all the ones I've had before. He's almost a perfect Leicester Square Theatre podcast guest, actually. And I think he's funnier in this one. It's a really great one. So I would just fast forward through me saying all this stuff and get straight to it because it's really good. But if you want to listen to me speak a bit longer, I'm just going to say that I am on tour in 2016 from January right through to June with my new show Happy Now, which is all about whether I have achieved any kind of contentment in my life now. I've got a wife and a baby. Look, there they are. Or whether I haven't. It's quite a funny show so far, I think. In fact, I think it might be my best show, possibility, because I'm still working on it. But I am doing a few gigs in January. I'm going to be at the Leicester Square Theatre from, I think, the 11th to 13th of February. So come along and see me there if you're in London. I'm doing the DVD at the end in the Bloomsbury in June if you're in London. But I'm coming pretty much everywhere else in the UK, or near enough. Meet me halfway if you live in Inverness or in Cornwall, which I would love to come to those places, but not enough people come to see me to make the carbon skid mark that I would make worthwhile. A lot of the ones I've done have sold out, so do book ahead richherring.com/happy_now/tour or richherring.com/gigs for all of the information about where I am coming. And that's a great way of paying me back if you've enjoyed these things for free and want to come and spend some money and have a good night out. And now I am a parent, I appreciate how important it is, those nights out. They're very rare for parents, and so I'm going to make sure it's as brilliant a show as absolutely possible, which implies that I didn't used to do that, which may be true. Anyway, let us crack on. Do come see me if you can on tour. That would be marvellous. If you don't like these podcasts and want to see me die in the gutter, then don't come and pay for any of the stuff that I actually get paid for. And then everything will stop. So that's a good way to stop me doing these things or living, is don't pay for any of the stuff that I ask you to pay me for. But if you do like my stuff and want me to carry on doing these, then paying me to come do a show for you in your town is a good way of keeping that going. God, that's gone on for 3 minutes. No one's going to have listened this far. Bums! See, I could say that and no one will ever know. Prince Charles is an idiot. Yeah. I can say that because no one is watching, so they'll never know about what I've just said there. That was libel as well. My proper shows are funny. Everything I do on Leicester Square Theatre Podcast and this is just improvised. I actually write my proper shows and they're good. See you in a bit. Have fun. There's a few more of these to go until there's a little break. Okay, bye. They can see me through the curtain. The curtain's been done wrong. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Leicester Square Theatre. You'll never guess who's coming on now. It's Richard Herring. Thank you very much. Hello. Hello, hello. Welcome to Richard Herring's Leicester Square Theatre podcast, or as some of the cooler kids have started calling it, RHLSTP. We'll just have a quick look at... So there's a nice bearded gentleman in the front row here with two badges. That's the kind of guy I like. Two badges. Still won't stop me taking the piss out of him. What's your name, sir? Matthew, that's a very nice name. What do you do for a living, Matthew?
Well, I like to think I'm semi-retired.
You like to think you're semi-retired? You're a postman. Well, that is very similar to my postman. Do you ever just put the letters through the wrong door on purpose, knowing that the person will have to go and put them next door for the person? Yeah, that happens to me a lot. It's an honourable profession that will very soon be redundant anyway. You're going to be replaced by a flying thing that can also kill insurgents as well. That's what you can't do that.
That's the downside for you. But lovely to meet you. Thank you for coming along. And thank you for buying two badges. That's £2. You're a good guy. I'd like to introduce my guest for this week's podcast. You're much better than the bloke in the front row of the last audience. He is probably best known for his appearance on Richard Herring's Leicester Square Theatre podcast. Which is now deadly. Someone's put them into the IMDb, so that is actually weird, but allowed. Will you please welcome David Mitchell, ladies and gentlemen? David Mitchell. There he is. Brought his own water. Welcome. Thank you. How are you doing?
Sorry?
How are you doing?
I'm very well, good. Thank you. I like the chairs.
They're new chairs.
I wasn't expecting such fancy chairs.
Things are going very well for us here.
There's a table, there's a range of DVDs. Yeah. And I mean, it's very...
You're welcome to have one of those DVDs, one of them.
thank you very much.
You can't break me. Yeah. It's lovely to have you back. What do you remember about your first appearance on... I would like to apologise, because I listened back to it to check we don't go over the same stuff. I was unnecessarily childish and rude. Yeah. I wasted your time with a lot of stupid questions beneath you.
I don't remember you being rude, actually. Yeah. I remember there was a point where you thought you'd been rude and you were worried the audience had turned on you because of that.
But and they had, rightly so.
I think it was just because we were entering our third hour of chat at that point. Apparently some sort of deadline sort of has been brought in as part...
There is, to stop us going on to, which is a shame.
We're not doing the full Ken Dodd approach to humour.
Which is a shame.
But I remember it being... The chairs weren't as comfy, the stage was more cramped. I think we had to be in front of this line.
Yeah, that curtain was closed, you're right. It was three years ago, almost to the day.
Yeah, now it's like Parkinson.
It's filmed. Yep. You couldn't see you last time.
Yeah.
Nice you're wearing a poppy. It is Remembrance Sunday today as we record this. fuck 'em. And when I say that, I am referring to the people who expect you to wear a poppy on Remembrance Sunday.
That's fine. Yeah. those are the people that all the soldiers died fighting. The people who wanted to make people wear poppies.
I think if those soldiers were alive again, they would want to kill those people. Right. Yeah. So
they would say this is an equivalent evil to that of fascism. I'm not getting into that, not in the age of Twitter.
But you know, history.
I think all the people who are really cross and have a lot of time to go on about things are right and should be deferred to.
Okay. I say history is written by the winners, and you know,
I think it's
Hitler wasn't that bad. That's what I'm saying.
I think history is written by the people with most time on their hands sending more and more furious tweets.
Anyway, I should apologise for being so childish and wasting your time with questions. But if you were going to go on holiday with... you had to go for a week's holiday with one of the puppets from Spitting Image.
Right.
Which puppet would you choose? Bear in mind, firstly, the puppet is going to choose the holiday destination.
Right.
And you will be accompanied on the holiday by both the puppeteer and the impressionist who does the voice of the puppet, but you will not be able to talk to them or refer to them, and they'll just blank you if you try to have a conversation with them as themselves.
So they will just continue to play the person represented by the Spitting Image puppet.
Yeah.
So it will be going, as it were, going on holiday with a caricature of an 80s politician. Or another 80s celebrity.
Yes.
I don't know. I'm probably the easiest going holiday would be probably the 80s Spitting Image puppet of Melvin Bragg.
Okay.
I think it'd probably choose quite a nice. I think they. I'm thinking them as they. The puppeteers and the object.
Yeah.
Choose probably quite a nice destination,
do,
not too challenging.
It would have to go somewhere quite refined.
Yes.
Probably quite nice food. It's a very good choice.
Exactly. So I think, you know, and it wouldn't be too, you know, whereas if you, I mean, the showy choice would be some member of the Thatcher cabinet.
Yeah.
You know, the screeching sort of Douglas Hurd puppet. Yeah. But I think that would just be wearing. And I wouldn't just be going on this holiday for the anecdotal value. I'd want to just have a nice, relaxed time. So So maybe, if not the Melvin Bragg one, maybe one of the general members of the public puppets that weren't a specific celebrity. Because I imagine whoever did the voices for that would be grateful for the holiday. The puppeteer wouldn't be, they wouldn't have had the best puppeteers on those, you know, those normal members of the public. So yeah, maybe one of them, if not the Melvin Bragg.
Okay. Good. It's a very thorough answer, as I'd expect from you. You used to work, of course, in the cloakroom for at TFI Friday in the 1990s.
Yes.
Did they ask you back to do that again?
Yes. But only as a sort of, you know, as a thing.
Yeah, okay.
As an amusing stunt to make it fun.
Okay.
And I didn't want it to be fun. It wasn't fucking fun when I was working in the cloakroom. But I will say, what I was, in fact, was an usher at the Riverside Studios.
Yes.
I wouldn't want people to think that television in the 90s was so sort of massively successful that a television show had a full-time cloakroom. But, you know, there would be somewhere for the people on that show to leave their coat or cloak, even on a Tuesday when the show wasn't on until Friday. It was only something, if you were ushering at the venue they recorded it, you were on cloakroom duty when TFI was being recorded.
Did you have happy memories? You didn't work on, were you there when we did This Morning Rich Not Judy? You must have gone by then. That was late 90s.
Yeah, I was there 90... Yeah, I was there 97.
Right, nearly. So you could nearly have taken my cloak from me.
Yeah, yes.
And stored it.
I wasn't of a pay grade where I took the cloaks of, you know, of the key talent.
No.
I took only the cloaks of the crowd that they sort of, you know, that they had to fill up that bunker with and make it seem so fun to everyone watching at home. The poor people who'd arrived expecting that they were turning up for the party that was represented on television and then were quickly made aware by us that they weren't allowed bags or coats for fire reasons and there'd be nowhere for them to buy any drinks or anything, and what they'd be doing was standing around being made to dance and being shouted at for getting in the way of the crane camera.
Happy memories of that time. And since we last spoke, you have had a baby daughter, as have I.
Yes, indeed. Congratulations.
Thank you, it's very nice. Yeah. You named your daughter after my mum, which is nice as well, so thank you for that.
I think to be fair, I mean, I only now know the name of your mum by some very quick backwards reasoning. I hate to tell you, it was, I think, largely a coincidence.
Okay.
Yeah.
My mum's very pleased about it.
Right, well, in which case, let's go with it. I've long admired your mum.
Now, I want to talk to you, daughter. You know, this is a weird thing because you're famous and your wife's famous. The Daily Mail, I've noticed, has done, when I was just researching, they've done the same article twice. And the article, and it's only online, I believe, this is not the paper Daily Mail. But in July, they had a picture of you with a beard wheeling your daughter around in a pram. And they specifically say, playing the doting father, showing he's a hands-on dad by pushing. And that is the Daily Mail. That is, it's feminism gone mad. He's the doting father because he pushed a pram along for a bit. And so there's quite a long article about you being out pushing your daughter around in a pram.
Yeah, they managed to get quite a few words out of what is a very basic concept.
I mean, it's kind of horrific, but then they have done the same thing again last week, I think, but this time you have a moustache.
Yeah.
So that is that's an additional...
Yeah. I think it says something like, I debuted my tash. That's where I chose to debut it. In my own street, trying to go about my business. But if they think about it, there's actually no way that a moustache that's already that long can have been debuted on that occasion. I've been debuting it in the mirror for weeks. I've debuted it among friends. So in fact, it's quite old, an old hand, that moustache, in terms of clinging onto my upper lip.
To be honest, it's nearly exactly the same article. Generally, almost word for word, they go on about who came to your wedding. And they say, in both of them, they choose the celebrity guests included David Baddiel, his wife, Morwenna Banks, and Connie Huck. I'm guessing there were more famous people than those three at your wedding, but it's just that's like, ooh, ooh. The woman who does the wife of Peppa Pig was there. Bloody hell. But then the second article, the first article is written by Jennifer Smith for Mail Online. The second article, which is exactly the same except it's noticed you have a moustache, is written by Sarah Tetter for Mail Online.
Yeah.
I think Jennifer Smith should have a go at Sarah Tetter. She's doing a lot of the same work. But yeah. How does it... I mean, that is just... It's really made me cross seeing this. And also feel very sorry.
Well, no, essentially, when you go onto the Mail website, you're expecting better celebrities than me. You're expecting people, you know, who are in the south of France showing their artists.
I'm certainly
pottering around North London with a pram.
I'm expecting better celebrities than your daughter, which I don't want to insult her, but she's done nothing yet. And that is, she's been in nothing except the Daily Mail once before.
She'll never escape the shadow of your mother.
What do you are you aware that as you're walking around in your daily life that there are people waiting with cameras taking photos of you? See them?
No, at once. In my life I have occasionally been aware of that. In terms of they've taken I think 3 or 4 pictures of us just, you know, I mean literally going about our business, just walking up the street, wheeling a pram, and only one of them did I actually spot a photographer.
Right.
So, you know, in general, they are hiding.
Right.
But that, sometimes you have to do that, you know, when you're for the very best journalism. You have to be willing to do things that seem a bit odd, like hiding in hedges in a suburban area, taking pictures of families wheeling their babies around. But otherwise, we you know, there's no way of scrutinising people who wield power.
No.
So that's. But no, I wasn't aware of it, and it obviously it is extremely annoying.
Yes.
But you sort of realise it's the thing. It would be slightly flattering, in that they think that anyone would be at all interested. If it wasn't for the fact that it's on the internet where there is no limit of space. So they might as well fucking stick it up there. Because it just... And that's a phrase taken out of context. So it's not as if they've actually said, well, I tell you what, let's not report the new thing about the Euro because these people are so interesting and we want a nice picture of them looking tired. They've just said, oh yeah, no, some creep got this snap, we might as well stick it on the internet with all the other crap. It's very annoying. But the thing is, you get such a sense, particularly from the Daily Mail, of hostility towards anyone who's on TV and, you know, might not be quite as right-wing as they'd hoped, that you sort of know that any expression of your annoyance would only be gratifying to them. So, you know, I rather pretended I hadn't noticed it until now, Richard. So
sorry for bringing it up. Well, maybe if you've been a bit less successful like I am, no one would give a fuck about it. I've printed up loads of leaflets with my baby on them, trying to get people to... No one's interested. No one will take them. They're not interested. While we're on the internet, then we'll get this out of the way. I didn't do this with you before. There's a website called Dirty Britcom Confessions. Have you seen this?
I have not seen that website. No. I'm aware of it only from listening to other podcasts of yours.
So there's people out there with harbouring sexual fantasies about you. For example, they're mainly relatively benign. Why is David Mitchell so attractive, dressed as a vicar? It's a rhetorical question there.
Is it a rhetorical question? Do they then go on to answer it themselves?
No one has answered it. There's just a picture of you dressed as a vicar. I would say, not. I don't think the moustache is your strongest look for me.
No, I don't like...
When I'm masturbating over pictures of you. I like the bit...
Those are the ones you pick when you want it to really last. I think the moustache I debuted on the Mail website was one I was growing in order to sort of look not nice for a role. I don't think I look nice with a moustache.
No.
But I think the vicar outfit is is a good look for almost everyone.
I suppose. There's a sort of
quite sense. Smart. There's a sense that you're judgmental, which people like. There's a sense that maybe you're not allowed to have sex with them, which you know makes people want to have sex with them more, probably. So I think it's obvious. Anyone probably, on average, looks more attractive dressed as a vicar. Which is why there's all those, you know, women dressed as vicar clubs. You know, dancing around a pole dressed as a vicar. You know, the place stinks of semen.
There's a couple more I'll go through. There's one I have to read out, which I think the one that I have to read out may have been written especially for us. After hearing David Mitchell use all kinds of curse words and filthy language, I can't help but wonder if that's what he sounds like when he's fucking. Is it? I can imagine.
Do I swear a lot while having sex? Yeah. No. I think you swear a lot when you do DIY. No. I don't think I particularly. Because
What do you sound like when you're having sex?
I don't know, and I'm not going to try and do it here. I think that's, it's already. I mean, basically, it's already so rude, isn't it? Having sex, you're already being very rude. So there's no need to gild that particular lily of filth.
If anything, just a quiet apology for what you're doing. I do beg your pardon.
Yeah.
All right, this is the. Like, I think people have got wind of me doing this and then have deliberately written ones. And I'll present the evidence for you, but it is quite funny. I want David Mitchell to slowly emerge from a giant vat of mayonnaise into the waiting arms of an oily and excited Richard Herring. He proceeds to lick the mayonnaise off of David Mitchell's semi-gelatinous body, except for his anus. So you're by the time I finish, you'll be covered in mayonnaise as you come out. By the time I finish, I haven't eaten a lot of mayonnaise. I don't think, and all that, you'll be naked now and clean, covered in just my spittle, and I imagine there were surely some mayonnaise smears as well. I don't know how thorough a job I can do, but especially the more
with that amount of mayonnaise, you're going to need to throw up at several times during the process.
I don't really like mayonnaise. If I have a little bit on a sandwich, I will usually scrape it off.
Right.
I find it too much.
No one wants it on its own. Even flavoured with me, as it undoubtedly would be. Particularly towards the end of the process when it started to congeal.
Yeah. But then you'll be... So let's say I've got it all off, but your anus will be... There'll still be...
A little yellowy, yellowy region around the anus, because it will have gone a bit yellow, the mayonnaise, by that point.
Yeah.
You know.
I mean, the question is: is there a reason I've avoided that? Was there? I don't know. After that, they have unlubricated sex and talk about the Bible. They are both ashamed and beg God for forgiveness.
Blimey, I thought it had ended with the mayonnaise anus thing. So.
Would you be up for that? I mean, there's a lot of expense because we have to get a vat of mayonnaise. We have to source a vat that will contain enough mayonnaise for you to...
For me to slowly emerge. There's to be no bounding out of it.
And I presume, for it to work, I can't be there when you get into the vat of mayonnaise.
Yeah.
Because that would spoil the fun for me. So there would have to be some very careful system worked out. Whereas when you're in the vat of mayonnaise, there's some signal from the third party
I'm on to go in.
Otherwise, you're drowning.
Or I could be on some sort of oxygen tank.
I suppose.
Underneath the surface of the mayonnaise.
Do I have to lick that clean as well now? That's just that.
That's the only way to surprise you. You're just wandering into the mayonnaise vat room as normal. I don't know, to fill up. Maybe you're working in a restaurant. You're having to fill up the little jars of mayonnaise on all the tables. Just go, but it's your birthday. They've got a surprise for you. Richard, just pop into the mayonnaise vat room and fill up the little jars. You go, oh, it's my birthday. Surely I'm excused that particular chore. But no, you're made to. And then, it's all nice because, as you dreamt of, I slowly emerge. And that's the only plausible scenario.
I think surely it has to be your birthday on this. I don't think that's a birthday.
I'm sorry,
not a licking involved.
I can only imagine you enjoying it more than me.
Oh, dear. So, we'll talk briefly about Peep Show. And it's the last series of Peep Show. I think by the time this airs, this goes out, they may all have gone out. You can just tell us everything that happens in the last series.
Well, as long as everyone's staying in this room it goes out, right? Well, it starts in the time of this. Yeah. It starts.
You're going to look really weird with that poppy on by the time this goes out. Yeah. You're going to like a right head case. I love them. It's like this New Year's Day. He loves the.
He's so un-Christmassy. He just wants people to think of the fallen. it starts on Wednesday.
Yeah.
Last six episodes. Very, very. I think it's a really good series. We're very sad it's ending, but we're too old now, or we will soon be too old. I'd be careful to say we're not too old now, because that's like it's already we shouldn't be making it. But we are becoming too old to play men who are basically in the sort of post university late 20s, early 30s bit of life.
I think it is. I mean, it's a sitcom that's spanned a decade and a bit, and the audience has got older with you as well. But I think also in this day and age, people do stay in that arrested development till their 40s. So I don't think it's unbelievable. I've certainly got friends. And one of the people that I could mention, by the time I was 40, was still living like a student, really.
I think it's not like it's implausible, a Jurassic Park film. it's just that their failings just become it just darkens slightly.
Yeah,
it's always been quite dark, but we wouldn't want it just to become sad.
Yeah.
But
do you think I saw something, there was scope about coming back when you're older and doing specials and things like that. Do you think that might happen?
I think we definitely love to do some sort of thing about them in 10, 20 years' time, a sort of whatever happened to kind of thing. And I think Sam and Jesse, who write it, are keen to write that. But we just sort of think, let's draw a line under the initial show.
Yeah.
And because we've done loads of episodes. We haven't done the sort of two series and then quit while people are wanting more. We've made sure that people definitely are sated. Yes. And everyone is full.
Yeah.
Of that.
I think they could. I watched them all. So I think they're on Netflix, aren't they? So we watched the entire lot in the space of a few weeks. And they really hold up well. They're really, really fun. I think there's something about it, because I think once a show becomes that ingrained in your life, you've seen it over that many years, it sort of is. I think it's going to be sad for the audience as well as for you. I imagine it was a difficult thing to leave behind once it's been part of your life.
Yeah, but the thing is, you end up looking back, we started doing it 12 years ago, and you sort of realise, fucking hell, I'm 12 years older now, and that's that's a significant percentage of the time I'll be alive. Mm. And in some ways, it feels like it was just now, and it makes you think about mortality, which is probably a good thing to think about occasionally. It doesn't necessarily put you in a good mood. So maybe it will be, comically ruined by the fact that the viewers will just think about mortality themselves. They'll remember when they first saw it and how many things haven't gone right for them since then, how
terrible.
Naive their dreams then really were. And,
it's true. If you had to list the Peep Show episodes from least favourite to most favourite of your own personal, which episode would be the mean episode?
a really, really good average one. I think. I mean, immediately, there's so many average ones to choose from. But I'm immediately thinking of the sectioning episode.
Okay.
Series 3, which I always thought was pretty good, but certainly not my favourite.
Always wondered about that. That's good.
It's,
Has your brother seen any more ghosts since you were last?
I haven't asked him, so I don't know. But he hasn't brought it up.
No, he probably would, wouldn't he?
I think he probably would, because, you know, at family gatherings there are silences. And if anything that interesting had happened to him, he would, you know... I think he'd pipe up. He's shown no signs of having changed his attitude to the world as a result of having seen something which, in general... I mean, he doesn't really believe in ghosts, but he thinks he's seen one.
Yeah.
So,
was he excited that he was mentioned on my podcast?
If so, he has never mentioned it. But, yeah.
Okay. So how are you enjoying being, aside from all the horrible paparazzi bits, how's it going so far? You're 6 months in nearly?
Yeah, nearly 6 months in. And yeah. Although
it gets much more interesting after the first 6 months. That's the most annoying thing, but wherever you're at in the baby process, other people go, oh, yeah, I love 6 months. That was such a lovely time. Or they'll go, oh... You wait, see what's coming. By month 9, you wait and see what happens. Do you find that?
Yeah, well, it's certainly true that nobody goes, oh, I know not a jot more than you. All of the parenting skills that I've used on my now 14-year-old boy, I had learnt by the time he was 5.5 months old. So, no. So, yes, people do that a bit. But, you know, it's nice people take an interest, really. It's amazing. Really, it's frightening, but it's lovely, and you know.
And are you more hands-on than, you know, pushing the pram around a couple of times when you see someone in the bush?
I have, on occasion, actually put my hands on the baby. My own child.
Very modern. It's very modern.
Absolutely. Picked her up and just literally acknowledged her presence on almost a daily basis, which, you know, is very, very modern. And it's probably... Is it PC gone mad? I think it might be.
I think it's insane. Yeah. I feel very privileged myself to be... I mean, I've talked about this... I'm doing a show, as I say, partly about becoming a father. But I feel, like, sorry for the previous generations of fathers who weren't encouraged to, or, you know, were expected not to get involved.
Yeah.
Because all the horrible little... The things you sort of think, oh, that'll be awful, that'll be terrible, those are the sort of... the lovely moments.
There's nothing... I mean, it's frightening because you're aware that there's a tiny human that really can't look after themselves.
Yeah.
But all of the things you have to do, like, you know, the things I was worried about, you know, nappies and... bottles and sterilizing. It's really easy to learn, and you totally get used to it. And then there's just the lovely thing of a new person that suddenly starts to recognize you and smile and laugh, and it's brilliant. So it must have been very weird at the point when, you know, the Edwardians, they'd say, well, I've seen my child and I look forward to meeting him when he graduates.
It's a very joyful thing. Do you think she'll be funny? Is she going to... Because my daughter's very funny. And I concede that you have won the competition of who is the funniest out of me and you. But now we have a new generation. And I intend to live vicariously through my daughter and train her up to be a super comedian. Are you... To mainly beat you. And any children Stuart Lee has. What, are you going to do the same, or are you going to let her do what she wants?
I hope she doesn't want to be a comedian or in show business, because if she was really funny, it would poison me.
Yeah.
And I'd go, I want to be funnier than my own daughter. And I'd turn into a sort of Darth Vader figure. I don't think it's necessarily wanting to be a performer. It isn't necessarily the shortest route to happiness. So if she wanted to be a performer, you know, brilliant. I hope she's really good at it. And, you know, whether or not she is, I'll turn up and say she is.
Yeah.
But if she wanted, if she totally didn't want to do that and say wanted to be an extremely successful lawyer in one of the areas of law that are lucrative, I'd just support that dream. Or if she wanted to produce documentaries for Radio 4. That would be nice. That would be a nice, gentle, largely indoor work.
Yeah.
That involves thinking and pottering.
Yeah.
That's, yeah.
That'd be nice. I think
doctor would be good, of course.
Doctor.
Because then she could stop me dying.
Yes. Yeah. Well, they'll be doing a certain amount of that, so it's nice to have that. You know, I've left it a bit late because I think by the time I'm in a home, my daughter might not be old enough to look after me. But maybe if I can hold on, try and get fit again. That's what's exciting about a new person is this incredible level of potential. They'll obviously let us down and us them. That is the worst, the bigger crime of it all. But it's
no. I mean, at the moment, and this is an interesting fact. At the moment, my child is perfect, and if that continues, wow. And all I'm saying to her is if she stops being perfect, I'll be pretty disappointed.
But what's quite nice...
Why let go of that now?
They are perfect because they literally can't do anything wrong because they have no concept of right or wrong. So they can only be, which is quite a nice place to be. Whatever they do is right and there can't be any wrong. Yeah. And that's what... The tragedy of knowing that innocence will be lost and that they will then know the world is a terrible place. Horrible, isn't it?
Yeah.
So never have children. That is my answer to you. I'm going to ask you another emergency question because you are the best at emergency questions. You gave the best answer for the ham hand one, definitely, that there were of the many, many times I asked that question. As nice as... kettle crisps are not as nice as they once were. Have I changed or have they? It's a rhetorical question. If you could travel back in time to compare any food of today with an equivalent in the past, one, what time would you go to? Two, what food would you be taking to compare and what would you compare it to?
Right, that's...
I'm saying I'd take kettle crisps back to find out whether they've changed or I have.
But you don't have to compare a contemporary version of a...
Well, if you go back so far that the thing does... If I said I want to compare kettle crisps to the kind of crisps a caveman might eat, then they won't have kettle crisps, as far as I'm aware.
So that would be just a random...
But I want to go back to the beginning of kettle crisps with a kettle crisp now and eat that kettle crisp and then I'll eat that old kettle crisp. I mean, it'll be new there because I'll be in that time.
Yeah.
And they go, it has changed. You're, oh, no, I've changed.
Well, I think what's distracting me about this is, are they not called kettle chips?
I don't think so.
I mean, I would be the first to admit that they are a type of crisp, but I think the brand name is kettle chips.
Well, I refuse to join in with that. They are crisps, and we're not American. Chips is an American.
Well, they are crisps, but they can still have a name that contains the word chips, can't they?
Well, were they called kettle chips?
I think they've always been called kettle chips.
Have they, though? Or have you changed?
It's true, I have started to see the word crisp to be the word chip. That's
it's not really about kettle crisps.
No.
Or chips.
I also, by the way, though, I agree with you, and I don't think they have changed. Right. But I think there was something amazing when they first came out about the way they were different from the standard crisps, and then that thing that was different about them turned out not to be nice. but it took several years before you realised, they're not just, they're so much crunchier, and then you realise, no, it's annoying, and it sort of spikes the roof of your mouth. And what's nicer is the Pringles that just turn back to their constituent mulch. What foods would I compare? I don't know. I think maybe beer.
Okay.
Maybe I'd quite like to do a time travelling sort of beer tasting, nerdy beer tasting.
Yeah, that would be good. Several stops.
Go back to where it was like the beer, it was just so weak, it was just there so it wasn't water so it didn't kill you, and then maybe the really strong beer that maybe Henry VIII might have enjoyed.
Some actual beers, like I think Budvar, which I like, is a Czech beer, but I think that claims to go back to sort of 1500s or something like that. So it'd be quite interesting to interested in taking it and then seeing what the difference between...
Apparently Guinness was a bit of a mistake.
Right.
That they sort of burnt something. Yeah. Tastes quite burnt. Tastes like a mistake.
Yeah.
So I'd quite like to try what they were making before that mistake. Because maybe it's nicer. Maybe I could actually put in a word for it and sort of go, I think you've gone a bit... You've gone a bit mad because you, this other beer is much nicer, but you're probably bored of it because you make it every day, and now this mad idea of making the stuff that tastes burnt has taken over the whole company, and you're ruining, you could be ruining a lot of people's evenings for hundreds of years to come.
How's your back, by the way, if it's your back?
Oh, is it? I had a bit of a flare-up a few days ago, but basically better.
Okay.
Basically
you're still better. Walking everywhere?
I am still walking, but it's ceased to have quite the effect on my weight it used to. It's like my metabolism has got used to that.
Right.
And puts weight on anyway, so I'd have to walk 2 hours every day, I think, to lose. And then that gets ridiculous because
you could run the same distance rather than walk it.
I don't like running. I did try running, yeah. but I it was horrible. It was really really tiring. What I like about walking is you don't have to get changed before or after. It might make you a little bit sweaty, but still basically presentable. Things where you have to completely change and shower. I think I resent that even more than the exercise.
Good. What is the worst emergency you've ever been involved in?
Oh,
it's a double emergency question because it's about an emergency and it's also.
I don't think I've ever really been involved in an emergency. No.
The
fire drills at school, but they weren't real emergencies.
No.
There was never a real fire at school. Oh, although I don't know if I was there, but I think a disgruntled ex-pupil. In my school put a sort of explosive in the organ loft of the chapel which resulted in the organist going deaf for 2 days.
Oh no.
But I wasn't aware of when that happened. I didn't think they had to clear the
That is so funny.
Yeah.
The posh terrorism. How can I get back in this school? I'll show them. They'll regret leaving that organ loft.
Yes, exactly.
Like the Guy Fawkes of organ lofts. It's like the high rise Guy Fawkes, but he succeeded. or Ian Gunpowder, as he should be.
He did better. I don't think Guy Fawkes deafened anyone.
No.
So it's basically, what are we doing remembering Guy Fawkes, a complete failure, when even I can't remember the name of this person who did at least succeed in deafening an organist for 2 days?
Do you think that David Cameron had sex with a pig from your experience of being at public school and Oxbridge? Is that the kind of thing that went on?
You see, it's interesting the way you phrase that question, because it's impossible for me to answer in the affirmative without implying that I've done something similar myself, which I haven't. But nevertheless,
what is the most similar thing you've done to having sex?
He's supposed to have just sort of stuck his cock repeatedly in a dead pig's head.
I think
rested his penis.
I'm pretty certain it's a made-up story.
Right.
But I think what he's supposed to have done, and this is just hijinks.
Yeah.
He's at a posh do. They've been burning money and kicking tramps and stuff. Yeah. And then someone goes, oh, look, I've got this pig, and you're a bit drunk.
Yeah.
And clearly on cocaine. Allegedly. Can you combine clearly and allegedly?
Legally, they have very different statuses as words, but yeah.
Definitely on cocaine. Allegedly, he was definitely. If David Cameron's never tried cocaine's, let him sue me about that. He's definitely taken cocaine. And then someone goes, hey, mate, put your cock in here. You might do that, mightn't you, if you were David Cameron?
If someone said that to me, I was trying, I know I wouldn't do that.
Right.
Because it would be embarrassing, and I don't like being nude in front of people I don't know indeed.
The pig helps with that a bit, doesn't it? It gets in the way of the nudity.
Yeah, yes, but
so if you were nude, and then someone said, here's a pig's head, you might go, well, cover yourself up. And the penis might just go in the mouth.
Do you think that's how it happened? That David Cameron was changing in a room on his own? And then everyone else burst in, and he just modestly reached for the nearest thing, happened to be a pig's head.
Yeah.
And as he was drawing the pig's head towards his genital area, accidentally his flaccid cock sort of slightly entered it. Well, in which case, I feel sorry for the man. Yeah. Yeah, I think there are lots of people who would in sort of... You know how on stag do's, there is sort of people will do things that they don't really want to do. You know, like people, like stag do's will sort of glumly go to a strip club when none of them want to go because they sort of feel it's sort of traditional.
Yeah.
And I can sort of feel that, that a group of people are very drunk and, you know, possibly also enjoying other substances.
Yes.
I mean, they've had a big dinner. they might think, just, you know, it's the sort of thing that people come up with because those people haven't really got anything to say to each other. They're not really talking. The conversation's not flowing, so someone says, we're going to have to get out their pig's head. I can imagine people would just do that to join in, and maybe he's that sort of person, maybe he isn't, but it's not like the most... impossible thing to believe. If that's the worst thing that's happening with powerful young people behind closed doors, then that's fine.
Yeah, I guess so. I think there's a sort of level, there is a certain type of people that the, perhaps you and I, a group of men that you, perhaps you and I were never invited or wished to participate with, who like drinking their own sick or spunking in a glass and making the last person spunk in it drink it and...
Yeah.
I mean, they play rugby and some things like that, which we, you know, there's a kind of homoerotic element to it.
Yeah, I certainly heard stories at university about drinking societies and dining societies that supposedly did crazy things, but I don't know. I've had no more actual evidence of that than I have of the Cameron.
Well, and then that woman at the Westfield sucked off her husband when she was pregnant and the kids were around. I mean, I think she should probably not be allowed to be Prime Minister now. That should be one of the things. They're not really punishing it for it. Let's go, if they ever get the chance, you're going to be Prime Minister, you can't be it. In case you start sucking off one of the, you know, Putin or something. I mean, it might actually be the way to solve all the problems, wouldn't it? If you go
but
to...
You've got to be able to deploy that appropriately, haven't you?
Yeah, you
to,
do. You know,
and she hasn't deployed it. Ultimately, sucking people off in circumstances where you're not supposed to suck people off is fine if you get away with it.
That is
it's
true.
Just all
same
it's like with Tony Blair invading Iraq. It's fine if you get away with it.
Fan of Tony Blair over there, very disgruntled. Oh, come on, lay off him. What's he ever done to you? Why do elephants have such low rates of cancer?
I didn't know they...
Well, they do. Why do you think it is?
Fresh air. I don't know. I suppose maybe they get their tubes rinsed out a lot with the inhalation of liquid. Is grey an anti-carcinogenic colour?
Cancer's mainly caused by people's tubes being clogged up.
Possibly. I don't know. With smoking, that's very bad for the, you know, like the tubes and people get...
Elephants don't smoke, do they?
They don't smoke. But they're I would say, even less likely to suffer from serious catarrh than a non-smoking other mammal.
Okay.
Because they're able... I mean, we can't do it, can we? We can't sluice out our noses by just simply... You know, I would love here, while talking, to be able to just simply place my long nose into that water bottle and, you know, sluice everything round.
Yeah.
It would be very useful as an actor if you needed to cry. You just... You know, in a scene, you just make sure you've got plenty of water up your nose and then close off the other areas and a little tear would come out then. And you could do it if you had different coloured drinks, you could have different coloured tears. That's immediately a special effect. So, I mean, I'm literally guessing.
Yeah. It's incorrect.
Yeah.
It's due to genes.
Fair enough.
Can you name another animal that is cancer resistant?
The cockroach, isn't it?
Don't know, that's not what I've got.
I've always assumed the cockroach was sort of cancer resistant because they would apparently do very well after a nuclear, a nuclear winter.
Yeah.
So that's...
The naked mole rat was the correct answer.
I certainly feel the fool.
That was the answer on the card. That's what I have to take.
The naked mole rat.
Yeah.
Okay.
Do you think having sex with robots should be considered infidelity, or do you think it should be definitely allowed? Because it isn't. I'm not trying to sway you, but it isn't a person.
Well, I hate to be pedantic.
Yeah.
By which I mean I've found an opportunity to be pedantic. But something being an infidelity and something being disallowed. Yeah. They're not. It's not the same thing. Is it? You are allowed to be unfaithful.
Yeah. Apart from Chris Hune. My wife won't let me.
Chris Hune went to prison for it. But I mean, yeah. They say it was about speeding points, but it wasn't. It was the whole country was so cross with the terrible way he treated his wife. Yeah. Which, you know, was sort of, I genuinely thought was an interesting sign of a sort of deep propriety in the British culture. Mm. And just to get a laugh out, I'm going to say boobs. And then you can just edit that together.
And we'll put that.
And the stuff about the propriety in the British culture really went across well.
Yeah. I imagine that's what you say when you have sex. That's yeah. what I'm imagining.
Boobs. Yeah. Boobs. Boobs. I'm upset by how much you seem to imagine me having sex.
But like a rogue, my wife says we were watching Humans,
yeah.
And I asked if I could have, if she would mind if I had sex with a robot that looked exactly like the actor Gemma Chan, mm-hmm. And she said that she would mind that.
Yeah.
And I argued that it shouldn't. It's only like a machine. It's not a human being, so she shouldn't be. I should be allowed to do it. And because they're not around yet, we have the chance to set the ground rules. Mm-hmm. So I quite strongly think that you should be allowed to have sex with robots, and that shouldn't count as being a bad thing.
What if you thought you were having sex with the real person,
yeah.
And then it turned out to be a robot?
That'd
so you
want a lucky escape.
So you think that, yeah. That would be fine?
It would retrospectively turn out. As
that
I was doing it, thinking, oh, it's a shame I'm doing this because this has ruined my marriage and I'll never see my child again. I mean, I'm enjoying it, but I'm that is spoiling it at the back of my mind. Right. And then at the end she goes, I am a robot. I go, oh!
would they be trained to say, I am a robot at the point of orgasm?
Well, I would like... Sort of,
and that would, that's the real, that's the bullseye for the, you know, someone who thinks that they're destroying their
what?
Existing
the
relationship.
The danger is that a human being... could say, I am a robot. Like,
now that's what I say while having sex. Now, I think there's no getting around the fact that it would probably be almost exactly as upsetting as...
I shouldn't,
you know,
be, though. Definitely shouldn't be.
Yeah, I mean, I
could... Like,
you
using
know.
Sex toys or having sex with an object would be weird, but it wouldn't be...
So, essentially, what you're making the reasonable point that the fact that this sex toy has become elevated to a more realistic level,
yeah.
Shouldn't... You know, that skill in the manufacturing,
yeah.
Shouldn't be penalised.
Exactly!
Not, you know, in the conventional sense. Yeah. For its own success. Yeah, I think, well... My wife is in the audience,
yeah.
So I'm going to say...
She won't mind you having sex with a robot, though, because it's a robot, that's the thing.
I don't think she'd mind me having sex with a robot that sort of looked like C-3PO. But...
When saying she wouldn't mind, would she like quite like that?
No, she absolutely...
She
hates
asked me before the show, is there any way you can slip this in, see if they would be up for it? It's the only one thing in our marriage that's not working for me, the lack of having sex, bumming C-3PO, is that then we're the perfect marriage. Not every time, but that would just be a little...
Bumming C-3PO. There's no orifice there.
That's the beauty of a robot, though, isn't it? You can just get a sort of drill out.
I'm not a robot.
But he's
I
a robot.
Oh, is it? I get
you
a drill.
I can put a hole in him.
Yeah.
It doesn't matter because it's a robot. If you drilled into a woman, that would be...
I
disapproved of.
I don't think...
Yeah.
That you'll be ever be possible to fully enjoy the sexual act with an orifice you have drilled yourself.
What if there was mayonnaise in there?
There's no doubt that the mayonnaise would help.
Do you think having sex with a ghost should be considered cheating?
A ghost?
Yeah.
Yes, probably.
But what if you're asleep and the ghost...
Can ghosts have sex?
Yes. obviously. And they often do. You say you're asleep and you wake up and there's a ghost and it's mounted, you're on top of you and it's having sex.
Well, would you raped by a ghost? Yes.
They don't have the moral code that we have in the afterlife. Would you immediately say, please get off me, that is inappropriate?
Please get off me, headless highwayman.
Or would you say, it's okay, it's just a ghost, I'll just finish off? That's, and my wife cannot be upset by that, because it's a ghost.
I think it would be possible at that point just to allow, if you wanted to, allow the ghost to finish the process, but then claim that you didn't have the opportunity to intervene before it reached
fruition. Just say you were asleep the whole
just
time.
Just say, I had only just the last moment when I ejaculated, I woke up and realised I'd been raped by a ghost.
Yeah.
And I'm so sorry, darling. But also, I'm not sorry. I want to go on television and say about my terrible experiences of being violated by a ghost, and more people need to realise that this can happen. Also, are ghosts in this world, what do they feel? Because sometimes ghosts are just a sheet with two holes in it.
Yeah.
Sometimes they're sort of a see-through person. Yeah. You imagine if they walk through, you just shiver. And sometimes, like in Ghostbusters, they're sort of made out of a kind of gloop.
Yeah. That'd be the best type.
We need to... I think we need to know what they actually are, before any of this conversation has any meaning.
I don't have all the answers. If you could have sex with the ghost of any person who's dead, which person would you like to have sex with? If your wife... Well, no, I was going to say if your wife was sadly dead, but then you might want to have sex with her because she'd be a ghost. So your wife is being kidnapped by a gang for a long time. She's been away for a long time. It's taken a weird turn. So say, which historical character would you most like to have sex with if you were in the position to do that, if they were still alive?
Someone like Grace Kelly. She's very sexy.
Okay.
I mean, it wouldn't be... She's not historically interesting. No. I'd rather meet Napoleon.
Okay. But
I don't know. The question would be, if you can only meet these historical figures by having sex with them, would I be willing to endure sex with Napoleon in order to meet such an interesting historical figure? Or, going back to Henry VIII, of course you've got the risk of venereal disease. Would it be? But then again, syphilis can be quite easily treated.
Now, as long as
you
get back,
you get to meet Henry VIII, interesting man. You end up bringing syphilis back from the 16th century. That's downside.
Yeah.
Or do you just go, Grace Kelly, film star?
Yeah.
That'd be fine. It's allowed, apparently, because she's a ghost.
Yeah. So it's either Napoleon, Grace Kelly, or Henry VIII.
No, not Henry VIII. I'm not interested in Henry VIII. But,
he was good looking when he was young. You picture him as that big fat guy with the beard and stuff. Yeah. But when he was young, he was really good looking.
But the thing is, I'm not gay, but most of the historical characters I'd be most interested to chat to are men.
Yeah.
Elizabeth I I'd quite like to talk to, but she definitely want to catch her early in her reign because she went a bit sort of bald and unattractive. Yeah. They say
that's very judgmental. Still had a nice personality. I think it might be a game show in this. If we can invent time travel, that's the first point. Then you could go, who would you have sex with in the past?
Yeah.
Just throwing out there. So.
You're throwing it out there, Dave. You don't make this program, then.
You said you don't want to work. I'll go to ask you. Ooh, my voice went funny. You said you don't want to work in America in an interview recently. Is that an absolute no, or you just prefer working in the UK?
I would just prefer working in the UK. I don't want to relocate and try and, they say that, they say they make a lot of films in Hollywood. and there's people... America is aware of British comedy and there might be opportunities there and some people want to go there and find that very exciting, and I can understand why they would, but I I don't fancy that, but I would absolutely, if you know, if they like offered me a good job.
Yeah.
If they, America, one of their meetings, my name came up. Yeah. Then yeah, it's not like I wouldn't do that, but I don't fancy relocating.
It's not, because a lot of people kind of go out there with the express intention of whatever. I mean, I sort of feel like in America the TV's better than the films. Like a lot of people now go thinking, oh, I want to become a movie star, and then they're in really rubbish films.
Yeah.
But there's some really amazing TV shows in America. I think they're kind of beating us, really.
Oh yeah. But I think the thing is, if you want to do that, you have to... I mean, firstly, it's a massive long shot. And secondly, if it comes off, you end up having to live there for sort of 7 years minimum.
Yeah.
And I like living here. And it's, you know, and it, yes, it would be odd to be there... sort of so, you know, being incredibly well paid for something that was going really well. And this is, you know, this is the jackpot. But sort of sadly thinking, I wish I could just go back and live in London where I like living.
Yeah.
And you know, I've got all this money, but the one thing I can't afford to do because I would have myself sued into non-existence is just to go and live where I was living before. So it's a bit like being a tax exile. Yeah. You know, this sort of go, I'm so rich... but I can't not live on Guernsey. Whereas there seem to be lots of people less rich than me who somehow can afford not to live on Guernsey.
And we alluded it slightly, but again, you were talking about... I think that's quite interesting about the length of sitcoms. So Peep Show is obviously you've done... is it 9 series or 10 series? Or
9.
9, yeah. And I thought
it'd be better if it was 10, wouldn't it?
Yeah,
it would be more of a round number.
Well, though they're all like 6 or 8 long, so it doesn't make any difference.
We'll cross the 50 episode mark.
Yeah,
which you know.
Yeah, but I think you feel the same. But I think there's a lot of, because of Fawlty Towers, everything's we have to do 12 episodes. But there's lots, you know, the American sitcoms, admittedly, with a lot of writers go on and do 100 good episodes, and The Simpsons did 150, 200 really good episodes. And then a lot more after that. That are still all right. It just sort of smacks of like, oh, it's too hard to. You know, I think once you've got the characters established, I feel like the Peep Show could have been 22 episodes a year.
I think that when you've got with a sitcom, when you've got a situation that clicks, then you absolutely can, you know, repeat that situation and get lots of funny episodes and stories out of that. And I've always felt you'd sort of think. Getting that situation right is much harder than them doing another load of episodes in it. So you're a fool to yourself, really, if you don't exploit the situation once it's up and running and there's an audience for it. And that's what we've certainly felt with Peep Show. So in British terms, we've mass-produced Peep Show. But obviously in America, where they've got so much more money and they can get huge teams of writers and do 22 episode series, they you know they would laugh at us and they would have... done
that'd
200
be, that'd
episodes.
Be good though, wouldn't it, if they were laughing.
Yeah, no, exactly. Laugh, but with derision. They can't. Yeah. You
know, it's hard to tell though. Yeah. That you could walk away going, oh, "Well, they were laughing. That's good."
No, that's
they
true.
They weren't.
That's. I mean, that's an interesting. Yeah. Settling for derision. That's just, because it basically makes the same noise. It's like the comedian equivalent of just of deciding I don't need a relationship, I have money for prostitutes.
What are you going to do now? Have you got plans for stuff that you've been doing, Professor Brainstorm again, which is why you had your moustache?
Yes. And I'm doing a sitcom... written by Ben Elton, about Shakespeare, in which I play Shakespeare.
Okay,
we're recording that in January, February time.
Is it shit?
I mean, I both think and hope not, but we haven't made it yet. So you know, it might obviously, as with every artistic endeavour, it might be shit, and yet our attempts will be to make it very good, which means that if it is shit, it's even worse for us than if we just said, well, let's just deliberately make it shit. So I hope it's not shit. I think the scripts are really good.
Okay.
You know, I'm aware that, you know, he has, you know, his recent sitcom projects haven't been the best of his work. But he's aware of that as well.
His historical sitcoms were very successful, I understand.
Precisely. Yeah. So
that's pretty. No, that is pretty. I mean, I'm a big. It's sort of weird thing with Ben Elton. I was talking to David Baddiel about this because he knows Ben quite well. Ben gets upset when people like me say horrible things about him for some reason. But you know, it's weird because he's such. He was when I was growing up, he was so that important figure. Like he's the heart of the Young Ones and Blackadder and stand up. Mm. And it's interesting as a comedian because then also when you're a comedian, you understand how comedy fans work to you as well. You know what I mean? Mm. So because you held him in such high esteem, it's very hard for him to maintain that maybe without having. If he died when he was 24. It'd be amazing.
And I know he regrets that he didn't. He gets a lot more shit than he deserves.
Yeah, I think that is true.
And I don't know why that is, but the press.
I think it's because people like him. Thing you should take from it. There's a point. I think people have such high regard for him and liked him so much that sort of anything he does is going to sort of disappoint.
I think there's a great extent, and also the fact I always find it annoying that when there's a new comedy on TV in general, that reviewers sharpen their knives and they have really strong opinions about it, whereas to a certain extent dramas and to a great extent shows about documentaries or cookery shows or anything, that people just go that's fine, let that happen, they've tried their best, fine. Whereas a comedy, if it doesn't immediately isn't immediately perfect and hilarious, everyone will go, why are you bothering to do this? Why are you wasting our time with this unfunny rubbish? With all those bits that I found unfunny, why didn't you just put hilarious bits instead? Any fool can do that. It's very irritating and it's frightening in advance of doing anything new. But it comes from the fact that as a country, we care more about comedy than almost any other genre.
Yeah, and comedy's also, I think it's very difficult to like a comedy straight away. So I think possibly part of the success of Petro was that it was allowed to sort of bubble away in the background without having the problem. I guess part of the problem for Ben is that everything he does is going to be immediately like, right, is this any good? And then, it's not as good as Blackadder. So as my memory of what Blackadder was. Yeah. And I think nearly every comedy show I like, I hated the first time I saw it.
I think almost everything that's very, I'd say the majority of things that turn out to be very successful were a bit of a slow burn of the people at most quite like to begin with.
No, sure.
But anyway, we're aiming for not shit.
Okay.
That's good. Brilliant. Having got to know him doing the pilot and things, he is brilliant, fun and funny and full of ideas. And I'm sort of right back to the sort of being his fan that I completely felt watching Blackadder in the 80s.
Yeah.
And he's inspiring to work with, and I sort of therefore do sort of. And yet he has felt keenly the fact that, of late, anything he tries to do, people are quick to go, oh, what's this piece of shit now? why didn't you just do Blackadder and die? And that, at the end of Blackadder goes forth, when they all got gunned down, why wasn't that really happening to you?
If you could pass that message on to him. What's amazing about you, I think, is that you've done a role that would define a lot of people, but you're able to do lots and lots of different things. That's kind of it. I think someone being so strongly associated with something like Peep Show, you've managed to do so many other things that I don't. You know what I mean?
Well, I think it's meant
to be a compliment. This.
Well, thanks for coming out. I sensed that and therefore was embarrassed and didn't know what to say. I'm now searching for something self-deprecating to say, and I've found it, which is that because I'm such a panel show whore and have been born into the era of panel shows being, I've had plenty of opportunities to define myself as other things, because it takes Sam and Jesse months to write a series of Peep Show. It takes us weeks to shoot it. So a couple of hours in a studio and you've got, a half hour of comedy that will be repeated every 6 weeks on Dave ad nauseam. So it's sort of doing, having a disproportionate impact on the culture is comparatively easy when you're sort of on that list. That's of people great. Who do panel shows. Which I'm, I rejoice in being on that list because I they're fun and I like them and I like watching them. But I'm aware that they're that people certainly most people would say that there are enough.
Well, there are enough of the similar. I mean, I really like Would I Lie to You. I think it's my favourite one. I can't watch it very often because my wife is annoyed there aren't more women on it. So if you could sort that out, then I can watch it a bit more often. I did say that to I had Lee Mack on as well. Yeah. I know it's not your fault, but you know, you could say I'm not going to do it anymore until there's at least two women on.
No, absolutely. No, I'm aware. I don't think I'm personally making the problem worse, but I'm not. You know, neither am I doing everything I can to solve it. You know, but it's just apart from anything else, I am a man.
You are, you can't,
and I wish to continue to be on it. So, in a way, the material contribution to the male-female balance I make is entirely anti-feminist.
If I was...
To solve that problem, I'd have to do something so drastic. And I'm just not yet willing to make that step.
I'm considering making that step for that very reason.
Right. Yeah.
I might finally get on some panel shows. But Jermaine Greer wouldn't like it. That's the problem. That's who I'm... We opened up a can of worms right at the end of the show that I wish I hadn't gotten to. It's a brilliant show, and it needs, unfortunately, to stay with that male dynamic because the three of you are very, very good. It's a brilliant show, but also I think it feels like it should be a show that is equal with men and women because of the very format is just about people telling stories.
I think the episodes where there are too often in panel shows now the feeling is. Because there was that sort of ruling made that you have to have at least one woman on a panel show, that too often has the effect that there are never any more than one woman on a panel show, which creates an unnatural dynamic. And that means too often that the women that are on panel shows are there representing all womankind, which is sort of a ridiculous state of affairs. And yes, I think the episodes of panel shows in general where there are more than one woman are... better than the ones with one or none.
I think they probably suit people like you and me more. I think the Radio 4 shows often have, I've done Radio 4 panel shows where it's all women and me. And it makes me question why I've been booked. But there's been some mistake. But no, I think it suits you and I because we're more, conversational comedians, whereas someone like Mock the Week, that kind of bang, bang, bang is very much suits the male stand-ups because of the format, I think, whereas it's harder for the female stand-ups with a more lyrical...
Yes, environments where there's a lot of interrupting don't suit women or me.
No.
I don't like... interrupting is rude.
It is, that's why... that's the only reason I don't like Mock the Week is just want them to go, when you're doing that bit, just take it in turns.
absolutely. The times I've been on it, absolutely... there are lots of very funny people on it, but there's this a culture of interrupting that I find both. I come away from it feeling that people have rudely interrupted me, and I've been forced to rudely interrupt other people, which is a sort of, sends me into a deep maelstrom of bourgeois self-loathing.
And we'll have to, because the theatre wants to put on other shows. Ridiculously. So we're going to have to...
Who's on next?
I'm not sure who's on. I know that Tal Crandon's doing it in a couple of weeks. I can't remember who's on next. But it's gone for the people at home anyway. You've missed it. The people here, you might be able to come and watch whatever it is. It'll be good, because everything at Leicester Square Theatre is excellent. You did a voiceover for the Frank commercials about the drugs taking.
Yes.
Did you stop people taking drugs? Has that problem been solved?
Well, I tried to stop all the advertising executives who had taken them while I was doing the recording. I said, come on, can I at least wait until we finish? But they just wouldn't listen.
That's all. Yeah. Ladies and gentlemen, give it up for David Mitchell! How'd you like them sky potatoes?